Emila Baptist Church here to have our invocation. If you don't mind going up to the
Osby.
So I'm sorry.
I'm used to Osby, honestly.
First, I want to thank you for this invitation to come and pray with you at this hour. And those who know me know that I pray. I don't try to be publicly particular. I pray. Let us bow our heads. Our Father, our precious, kind, and wonderful Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. For all of you who got to have us do this day. God is here at this point in time. Now, Lord, I thank you for this body. This people recognize that you are sovereign, that you are the one that moves and makes things. I pray that you give them the wisdom, the understanding, and even more than that, the willingness to sacrifice. The truth. Bless each one. Thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. I'd also like to thank Reverend Lee. Thank you, too, for coming today. He was here to offer the invocation as well. We do have a quorum with 6 members, and now we have 7 members in attendance. Do I have a motion to approve the revised agenda?
Madam President, I move that we adopt the revised agenda as printed.
All those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries with 7 votes. We will now have recognitions with Mrs. Mona Davis.
Good afternoon. Before we start our recognitions, we have 2 special presentations. The first is the presentation of a special resolution by the Lowndes County Board of Education to the late Beverly Laws. And with that, we'd like to ask Ben Taylor, would you please come forward? This is one of several notes of kindness, gifts, expressions that have been given on behalf of Mrs. Ross, which is indicative that her influence and her spirit was felt beyond just Montgomery. And so this is the proclamation that Lowndes County sent. I'm just going to read a little bit of it. It says, "Whereas Almighty God in his infinite wisdom and mercy has called from our midst the spirit and talent of Beverly Ross, whereas during her 11 years of service to the Montgomery County Board of Education, used her voice to express the diverse needs and challenges of public education in her district, whereas Ms. Ross's success was due to her passion for public education and firm commitment to knowledge gained through a wide array of professional development and networking, and whereas the passing of Beverly Ross, the state of Alabama has lost a highly valued educator who provided reliable, thoughtful, compassionate service. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Lowndes County Board of Education hereby expresses deep sorrow at the passing of Beverly Ross and offers its heartfelt sympathy to her family, members of this body, and the community, and all whom she served." And is signed by the Lowndes County Board of Education President Ben Davis and Superintendent Daniel. Thank you so much for being here. Is the kind we always like to give, and that's the gift of a donation. And joining us tonight are representatives from the Omega Iota chapter of Omega Psi Phi fraternity. Would you please come forward?
Please come forward.
Joining us is Ernest Colvin. Carlton Merriweather. And Rodney Ziegler. I was only expecting one, but I'm happy to have three. Okay, and I'm just going to come forward and make the presentation.
Good evening.
Good evening.
On August the 8th, 2015, the Omega Psi Phi Fraternity Incorporated, along with Project Perseverance Foundation, hosted an inaugural Get Fit for Education 5K Run Walk. The proceeds from this event help aid in our scholarship efforts and educational efforts for the kids in our community. We're glad to say that we raised over $5,000 to aid in those efforts. And what we would like to do is give back to the Montgomery Public School System. What we've already done, $1,250 has been earmarked to the MPS to include $600 to Nixon Elementary School, which is an adopted school, and we do a lot of programs there. $250 will be given to Wilson Elementary, where the 5K run walk was held in their community. And today, we would like to present a check for $350 to be used to help kids to get the proper clothing and uniforms for the school. So again.
Who have distinguished themselves not only on the state level, but also on the national and regional level as well. And they're all in the hall, they're excited, it's hot out there, and they're ready to get in here. So with that, first up, I'd like to recognize a group of outstanding students who are really no stranger to our board. They have been presented numerous times for their work in the community. And with that, I'd like to invite the Lehigh AL-11 Air Force Junior ROTC unit to please come forward. Let's encourage them as they come. Tonight by retired Colonel Antonio Douglas, who's there in the red, who is their instructor. AL-11 was recently awarded Headquarters Air Force Junior ROTC Silver Star Community Service with Excellence Award for the 2014-2015 school year. This is a prestigious award that recognizes only the top 5% of all Air Force JROTC units, and it's based on their community service in support of their school and local communities. Only 45 of these units receive this designation across the country. They are very active in the community, and some of the projects that they did last year, to give you an example, is they did a Thanksgiving canned food drive, they adopted a family for Christmas Clearinghouse, they did a school cleanup day, and they did a Red Cross blood drive, and I'm aware of many, many others that they have done. The unit has also distinguished itself as a distinguished unit. They were named a distinguished unit by the headquarters, JROTC, and last year they were selected as the 2015 River Region Youth Group Volunteer of the Year by Hands on River Region. We applaud this group for their service and for representing Lehigh and our district so well. Please join the board in congratulating the AL11 on this distinction. Thank you, students. They can come this way. I didn't know if they were going to be officially dismissed by you or from what. So not officially. I don't know what to do. Next, we'd like to recognize an educator whose dedication to the field of special education has been recognized with a prestigious award. And with that, with gifted coordinator Susan Morrow coming forward. Susan Morrow has worked in our special education department for?
Since 1978, how's that? 38 years?
Well, she has now been named the recipient of the 2015 Alabama Association for Gifted Children's Lifetime Achievement Award. Received the award at an awards banquet last Friday, and the award is presented to the person who has made significant contributions in gifted education for the entire state of Alabama. Susan has more than 30 years of service in gifted education and was selected due to her ability to create an environment for continuous improvement, developing and sharing teaching materials, her commitment to professional development, her selfless attitude toward teachers. And I've got a chance to read through some of the nomination letters that you received, and it's just evident that your body of research, the skill, and what you have brought to students has benefited teachers, not only in our community, but across the state, which is why you were selected for this prestigious award. So join us in congratulating Susan on this achievement. She is supported here by her director, Katrina Jones.
And I have two of my gifted specialists who did nominate me for the award are here, Ms. Beaver Burnett and Ms. Cheryl Thomas.
Thank you, Susan. All right, top awards. That's the theme for tonight. Next, I'd like to introduce you to a Career Tech student who received a top award during the Family, Career, and Community Leaders Association Conference in our nation's capital. And this is Kiana Hooks. Kiana is joined tonight by her teacher, LaShondra Brooks, Hospitality and Tourism Academy at Carver, and members of her family, Mom. Kiana won the silver medal at the FCCLA's National Leadership Conference in Washington, D.C., which was held right before the start of the school year. She competed against students across the country in the Career Investigations category of STAR Events, which stands for Students Taking Action with Recognition. She was awarded the silver medal, should have brought that medal today, which recognized her proficiency, her achievement in the chapter, individual projects, her leadership skills, and demonstration of mastery of key academic and career preparation skills. And I got to see some pictures of your trip. She got to, did you go to the White House or past the White House? Did they let you in?
No.
So she went by the White House. But anyway, we're so proud of what you're doing and the work at the Hospitality and yes. Tourism Academy at Carver High School. So please join the board in congratulating Kiana. great show on TNT called The Librarians. And it's all about these librarians who save our world from all these ancient dangers by researching the answers in books. And tonight, we have an outstanding librarian who's a superstar, too, because she's able to use her gifts and talents with students to encourage them to seek adventures through books. And with that, we're going to recognize Bellingraph librarian Carolyn Berry. Ms. Berry will be awarded the 2015 Herman Moore Lamb Award for Exceptional Service during the Alabama Library Expo's organization's annual event next Tuesday. The award is annually given to librarians and library media specialists who have rendered outstanding and exceptional service to their patrons, schools, and communities over an extended period of time. It also recognizes the important role librarians play in fostering a love of reading, research, and imagination for all people. And our students at Bellingraph, I'm sure, are all the better for you being there. Winners are determined based on letters of recommendation and their record of service. Please join the board in congratulating Carolyn Bell. On Monday, Montgomery Public Schools joined residents all across the community in celebrating International Peace Day. Well, we celebrated MPS Peace Day, which the board made a proclamation for at its last meetings. And in keeping with that, we had several students whose artwork was recognized with that competition. And their artwork is now hanging in City Hall and the County Commission and various other public places. So with that, we're going to announce the winners of Peace Within MGM's Young Artists for Peace exhibit. Okay, when I call your name, please come forward. First place and winner of the event logo was Nicholas Yen. Nicholas is a student at MCAT. Well, he was a student at MCAT. It's funny, he did the work last year and graduated, but he got the award this year. And so Walt found him and had him come. He's a former student of Walt Thomas. And if you remember Christmas time, Nicholas was here because he designed the Christmas card for Career Tech, and he won that competition. So we're getting to see Nicholas quite a bit and are happy to do so, by the way. Okay, second place in the competition was Jalon Lee, and he's also a student of Walt Thomas at MCAT. And I think Jalon's work is on display at City Hall, so if you have any business at City Hall, you can see his work there. We had two other winners. They were third place winners from Baldwin, Pearl Kassenbach, and Courtney Slater from MCAT, and Annie Zia. But they couldn't be with us tonight. But I would like their teacher, Walt Thomas, to stand at this time. Would you stand, Walt? Glad to do that. Okay. And please join the board in congratulating these students one more time for their accomplishments. First time as part of our recognitions, we are spotlighting student athletes. And tonight we are recognizing two young people who have excelled in their respective sports. They are BTW cross country athlete Savannah Perdue and Lehigh quarterback Shaquille Johnson. They are joined tonight by their coaches. Well, Shelly Brevet is joining us in spirit, but Tyrone Rogers. Parents, any parents out of here, would you please stand? All right, And we're also accompanied by MPS Athletic Director Brandon Neely. I tell you, it's tough up here, you gotta remember everybody. All right. BTW 11th grader Savannah Perdue may be shy when you first meet her, according to her coach Shelley Griffith. But she's explosive once her feet hit the track. She has competed at the state level for 2 years and recently medaled at the Prattville Invitational and placed 9th in the Children's Hospital Invitation known at Gateway Park. In addition, she plays violin with the BTW Strings. Lehigh 12th grader Shaquille Johnson has had a lot to do with the Generals' 3-0 record against its city rivals this year. And he played a lead role in Lee's defeat of Lanier, Carver, and most important to all Lee Generals, Jeff Davis, 31-23 last week. This is the second year that he has played football, and he serves as one of 4 senior captains on the team. He also plays basketball. But this young man, according to his coach, is not only a leader on the field, but off the field too. He helps organize other players in their community service work and participates in the annual Making Strides Against Breast Cancer Walk. And he takes a leadership role in the team's fundraiser and other activities that they do. And he is often singled out for his strong character and is respected by his teammates and fellow students. And for those many reasons, Savannah and Shaquille are our student athletes of the month. Thank you, students.
Congratulations. It's now time for our citizen comments. Is Mr. Van Taylor here? Okay. Well, I'm going to quickly go through the rules for citizen comments. Citizens may sign up for comments before a board meeting. The rules and procedures for public comments. Requests must be made in advance in writing to the superintendent's office by 4:30 p.m. on the Tuesday preceding the meeting date. Requests must have specified the nature of the business to be taken up with the board and the name of the person who will address the board to be added to the agenda. Communications must be respectful. Discussing specific student or employee matters will not be allowed. Individuals who have concerns that are inappropriate to be solved in this venue are welcome to seek a problem-solving meeting with the superintendent. Immediate feedback by the board may not be provided. However, you may be contacted for follow-up by the superintendent or designee. Public comments may not exceed 5 minutes. The board chairman has full authority to terminate the remarks of any persons whose comments contain personal attacks, exceed the time limit, or are otherwise inappropriate. A speaker may be considered disruptive who continues to speak when their allotted time has ended, when asked to stop speaking by the board chairman, or is otherwise inappropriate. If a person fails to comply when asked to terminate comments, he or she will be escorted to their seat, out of the auditorium, or off of the MPS property, depending on the level of disruption. So I don't believe Mr. Taylor is here. Next on the item is Mr. Dylan Nettles with Brainball.
Letting me be here tonight on such an eventful evening, I guess you could say. It really is outstanding to see all the amazing things that these MPS students are doing and being recognized for. So it's really cool to be here and see all of that tonight. And I got to straighten up, I think. Well, I'm actually here to share with y'all tonight about the Montgomery Brain Brawl. My name is Dylan Nettles, and I am the Community Programs Director at the Montgomery Education Foundation. This is actually the second year of the Brain Brawl, but it's been revamped a little bit, and the best part about the revamping is it's a little bit more money on the table. So all gloves are off this year. We are actually offering the opportunity for every school here at Montgomery Public Schools to win up to $1,500. So what can happen is a few different things. You can go out to your schools and your districts, talk to your principals. I actually had the opportunity to speak with them at the leadership meeting last week, thanks to Superintendent Allen. And many of them are really fired up about this, but I want to challenge you guys to go out there and follow up with them, see if you can get them to get a team started, whether it be their school staff, whether it be members of the community. At some of the high schools, you may even want to recruit some of the students. I know that's what Carver High School is doing. Shout out to Mr. Hall for assembling his team literally on the spot. And so we are really charging you guys to go out there and follow up with them. But also another alternative you have is you can go out there and ask some of the businesses in your community and those business leaders to sponsor a team. The registration fee is $150 for each team. But as I mentioned, they have the opportunity to win up to $1,500. The second place prize being $1,000 and the third place prize being $750. In addition, we'll have a ton of door prizes. We'll have vendors there who'll be offering gift cards and various items like that. And so it's a great event for the teachers, for the students, and for members of the community to come out and really take some ownership over their schools, take all their gloves off, no weigh-ins required, and really show them what you got for your schools. And so I want to invite you all to, of course, come out. You all have the registration packets, which include more details about the rules and the format of the event. And really go out there and, like I said, charge your schools and your principals to bring a team as well. They can actually have as many teams as they like from each school. So our goal this year is to have one team from every school in the system. But, of course, the more teams that are there for each school, the better their chances are of winning. So thank you for letting me be here tonight with you all. And if you have any questions, I'll be happy to take those now.
Thank you, Mr. Nettles. Thank you so much for this. Sounds like a lot of fun. Okay, that concludes our public comments. Now we have the superintendent's report.
Okay. Want to acknowledge this evening our school board, our community that's with us, and of course central staff. We appreciate your support. Tonight, I'd like to begin with a commendation to the Office of Student Support. I received a letter from one of our patrons, a parent who was very impressed with the services that she got at your office, Ms. Sophia. And I thought I needed to say that, because we don't hear that often. I'd also like to commend our CSFO and the federal program staff that worked on our budget. They put in some very long hours and hard work to bring our budget to fruition. Received a call last night from our CSFO at 7:20 that said, I'm at the office. So I sent in the troops and they were here till 11, and we have a budget. How about that? So I want to commend them for their diligence and hard work. Tonight, my report is going to be handed over to someone else to do after I let you know that we are very, very proud of our participation in Gear Up. I mentioned to everyone, Ms. Collins, you may not be familiar, but I gave you a little reading content, program description, and types of projects that are done through Gear Up. We have all of our middle schools, minus Magnet, involved in the Gear Up program. And of course, Gear Up is for gaining early awareness and readiness for undergraduate programs. What this program does is to support students beginning at grade level 6 to take a new focus on their future beyond high school. It prepares them to look at college opportunities, and definitely if not college, then of course 2-year or some other emphasis that will gain a lifelong set of employment processes for them. So I invited Dr. Claudia Williams, who is the regional Gear Up coordinator from the Gear Up grant that was given to Montgomery, along with Dr. Prentice Coleman. They take care of all of our middle schools and the programs that are going on in those programs. Dr. Williams, please have a word to say to our school board.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I am very pleased that I was assigned to the Montgomery system, Dr. Coleman and I. This is one of the most cooperative group of the principals, teachers, staff that I've ever worked with. And they are working hard to make Gear Up work in Montgomery. Not only will Gear Up work with your students from sixth grade through their first year of college, we also work with their parents to make them aware of the process of getting into post-secondary education. And so this process will last, as I said, for 7 years. We'll be here with these students working to make sure that they are successful, that they graduate from high school, and that they proceed into some kind of post-secondary education. And again, I would like to say I am so happy. Gear Up has 9,600 children. Half of them are in Montgomery. So that's why there are two of us assigned here. And we talk daily with your staff and with each other, and we talk about how happy we are to be here working with Montgomery Public Schools.
Thank you. The second thing that I'd like to do is I want to share a very short Gear Up video. Mr. Dodson, can you get the lights on this one, please? Thank you.
Listen up. It's never too late to change your luck. So don't let them steal your life.
What are you doing with your future, and how are you going to get there? We have an empowering program for schools in your region. And guess what? You're a part of it. Gear Up Alabama provides access to the tools and guidance you need in order to help you get to where you want to go. Are you ready? This is Gear Up Alabama.
Like the ceiling can't hold us.
Celebrating this opportunity. So every one of our middle schools has had an opportunity, or will have, to have a kickoff celebration of Gear Up this week. We attended several yesterday. We were at Carr But McKee and several of the schools have already had their celebration. So we are excited, and if you saw, if you noticed, there was the word free tuition up there. Oh, I think parents would love to hear that, because what that means is after high school, if they finish the program, if they complete it, they'll have an opportunity for 2 free years of post-secondary. And they're working on trying to make that 4. And so I'm just really excited. I appreciate the fact that the staff is attempting to make this work to help us utilize this. We've had a few kinks, but we are ironing those kinks out, and we look forward to the next 6 years of this program. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to say too, the children were pumped yesterday. It was really exciting to hear them screaming and cheering, and thank you. We're really excited about it. Okay, receive this information, AE rate contract, Mr. Steve Blair.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Madam Chairman, Madam Superintendent, members of the board, in your package, you have the E-Rate Professional Services Contract for Dynamic Strategies. MPS has been receiving E-Rate consulting services from this organization since 2007. Since then, MPS has received more than $21 million in E-Rate discounts and reimbursements. Some of the duties that Dynamic Strategies assist us with our training and guidance on the E-Rate management system for the district technology coordinator, guidance on document retention, meets with the senior technology staff from the instructional side and technical side to identify necessary applications to meet the district's needs. Assist with requests for proposals or RFPs, which are competitive bids required for all E-Rate applications, prepares all of the SCC forms for submission to USAC, which is a Universal Service Administrative Company, which is the company that runs the E-Rate program. Analyzes, researches, and prepares responses to all our requests from USAC in a program called Program Integrity Assurance, what we call PIA. That's when we fill out our application, send it in to USAC, they send us back questions. She prepares all our responses for us. Initiates the reimbursement process. This year alone, we started July 1st, we've received over $2.3 million in approval for reimbursements and for funding for this year. Any questions? Thank you.
Sorry,
I apologize. Sorry about that.
No, I like it. Okay. I think we're good. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
All right. Superintendent's Evaluation 2015-16 Overview, Dr. Nettle.
Sounds like we just did this yesterday.
I know. It does. And Dr. Nettles, I want to just thank you again for all of your help with this process. I could not have done it without you. I really mean that.
You're more than welcome. I enjoy the process. Good evening to the superintendent, to the board members, and the community. What I want to present to you tonight is an overview of the superintendent's evaluation process for the 2015-16 school year. And if you recall, the evaluation process is a 2-year process. So the evaluation runs concurrently with the contractual process, and so this is from 2014-15 and then 2015-16. Right, so good? Having said that, the evaluation instrument doesn't change, nor will the professional learning plan, with the exception of adding information from the professional learning plan and the results from last year's evaluation process. You received in your board packet the evaluation instrument and a timeline. Just want to remind you about the instrument. The instrument was developed in MPS. It's an MPS document, and it was developed around the 8 national standards for superintendency. And each of those standards have several indicators that further identify the expectations that we have for the superintendent's office. The instrument was developed to mirror the state's evaluation expectations, which includes a self-assessment, a professional learning plan and an opportunity for a growth model. So that's how this evaluation instrument is set up. So if you want to flip through it, because Ms. Collins, I do understand that you have not seen it before, but I want to just flip through it. If you look over on page 3, you actually see the standards that we've modeled the evaluation instrument after. This, the professional standards for superintendency, in addition to the state standards for advanced ed. Are we all there?
Yeah.
Okay. If you flip over to page 6, 7, you see the three components, an explanation of those three components, and that's that self-assessment. Now, the self-assessment is actually the superintendent's opportunity to take the instrument itself and go through it and self-evaluate to determine where those areas of growth and challenge, growth and opportunities are. So since this is a 2-year process, she won't do the self-assessment again, but those markers from the self-assessment, in addition to the evaluation results from last year, will create the professional learning plan. The second component are the performance indicators. And so if you flip to page 11, you'll see how the standards and indicators are broken up. Well, are there any questions about what we covered before you go?
No. We trust you.
But I wanted to let Ms. Collins have an opportunity to see the instrument and to see all of the standards and how it's laid out. And at the end of the process, there is an opportunity for each board member to rate within each of those categories, which is within each of the standards and indicators, and then we create a composite score from all scores. And so that's what we did last year. Since this is a 2-year process, the self-assessment was already done last year, but what we did as a result of the evaluation from last year, there were two areas of concern, and they were human resources and curriculum planning and development. And those two components have been integrated into the current year's professional learning plan. And I think you all are looking at, have looked at the learning plan. The learning plan gives you a synopsis of what was in there last year, including that evidence, but we didn't include all of that information, just what's going to happen for the current year. All right, so this is the important part. You should have also received a single page timeline. And if you, if you notice, we're in the July to August portion of it, where the superintendent will complete that self-assessment, which we discussed, and collaborate on the development of the learning plan. And what we did, we met with, and Superintendent Allen asked me to sit in, we met with each of the members of the senior cabinet individually and matched their job responsibilities to the evaluation instrument. And that's really helpful when you think about the areas of the instrument. So you match the roles and responsibilities that are going on in the system with the instrument. And so that was really helpful in the superintendent gathering continued information about what was going on in the system in response to those areas. And we were able to create suggested items to go through for the course of the year in order to make sure that the superintendent's challenges were met. We will present the learning plan to you also this year, but I want you to look at the green box at the bottom. The superintendent's evaluation must be completed in December of this year. Any questions or concerns?
Yeah.
Yes?
Looking at this timeline, you got July and August 2015, board approval, superintendent professional learning plan. When does that take place?
It's going to take place in September because Mrs. Allen had some personal family challenges in August and we weren't able to complete the process. Is that okay? I didn't modify the print because I figured we all understood why we were in September as opposed to August.
I have a question.
Yes, ma'am.
Is this something we're going to be doing online again?
Yes, ma'am.
I didn't almost tell you, I did not get a packet, and that's why, you know, for this week, so I don't have, that's what, you know, what they're looking at. I didn't get a packet.
Okay.
You know, I don't know, maybe my kids took it, or, you know, I'll check when I get home, but I haven't seen that.
You should have received one, I would check on it though.
Didn't come back yet.
Again, would you call them the Monday before the meeting and let them know, so they can, if nothing else, they can get you another one? And, well, we'll see all that later.
I will do, I assumed everybody would want to sign it, that's why.
Meet with me after the meeting, I want to make sure you're getting some stuff, okay?
And if push comes to shove between Renee and I, we can get you an electronic copy of at least my portion.
Yes, your portion then.
Ms. Note, it is all.
Right, that's what I thought, that's why, we'll meet after the meeting to make sure you have it.
Any questions about the December timeline? All right, so that means in November, we'll be back together to start looking at the evidence, to give you information about the e-board process, and to go over the evaluation instrument, just to make sure we're all in the same page, in the same place, and on one accord.
Okay.
I want to make one question to that document.
Yes, ma'am.
To pull out the contract to look, that January 1st date is on or before. So January 1st, 2016 is our deadline for that, but we can deal with that situation before that deadline. I just want to make everybody aware, and we probably should, since that will be during Christmas break. So we really need to address those issues in our December meeting.
Perfect.
And I'll make sure it gets, I'll speak with the chair and make sure we get that on.
Thank you.
Okay, what you were looking at before is the professional learning plan. And what I want to do is just open one page and just kind of show you how it's set up. The old objectives from 2014-15, and then that's one. That's this document now, the first one y'all had. Yeah, okay. All right, I just want to show you the setup so you can know the new strategies that have been added. The goals are basically the same, but the activities have been added for 2015-16, for these next few months. These are the things that we want to look at. That first goal again is in regard to communication. The expansion of that goal was to board, community, parents, and staff. Okay, if you turn to the next, that's on page 3. This again is that finance goal. And I expanded that for us to try again, looking at that 1 month's operating reserve, continuing to participate in trainings. You can see all of that. There are five added strategies for that goal. The next is in regard to my participation in the National Academy. That is still going on, and I'm still working on that capstone project that's a part of my work in the academy. And some of those things are related to the vertical school and the community school and that kind of thing. And the final one is related to the strategic plan. Now, this is where I inserted the HR and the curriculum and instruction pieces, because we are already working a strategic plan. We are already setting new goals for HR and for the work on teaching and learning. So we put those for the 2015-16 added pieces on that. You have this. If you have any questions about this, please ask. And we'll talk about it and or make any adjustments as necessary.
Any questions or comments? Thank you.
Thank you.
All right, attendance and discipline report, Mrs. Sophia Johnson and Mrs. Jana Langford.
Oh, okay.
Are they the same exact?
Are they the same? Okay, it's updated. It's updated.
It's updated.
Okay.
Okay, Madam Superintendent, Madam Chair, Board Members. As you know, I'm Sophia Johnson, Officer in the Office of Student Support Services. And what I'm going to talk about tonight is our attendance and discipline review. And this is the annual review that is required by the State Department of Education, and it will be on the intranet beginning tomorrow. Okay, Tom, if you'll go to the first slide, I wanted to talk about our total enrollment. And what we did was we went back 3 years, and this last school year, our total enrollment was 30,841. A year before, 30,924. I'll compare just the two, but we'll put all 3 years on the intranet. And as you can see, our total unexcused absences in 13-14 was 89,437. But on last year, it went down to 75,621. So that was a change of about 13,816. It is great. Our total number of students with the unexcused absences was 17,270 on last year, and the year before it was 18,567. But if you look at the total number of students with 10 or more unexcused absences in 13-14, that was 1944, but on last year it was only 1520. So basically, we're inching it down slowly but surely, but we are inching it down. And the percentage to our enrollment would be in 13-14, that would have accounted for 6.3% of our students, but in 14-15, that accounted for 4.9% of our students. Any questions on that page at all? Okay. The next one is our truancy intervention activities. And before I go ahead and talk about this slide, I really want to introduce you guys, in my opinion, to the hardest working individuals in Montgomery Public Schools. And that's my district resource officers. So if I can get them to stand, and I'll let them introduce themselves and tell you what schools they represent.
My name is Aronde Mitchell. I'm feeder program one, that's Jeff Davis Zone.
I'm Angelisa Hicks, and I have feeder pattern two, and that's Lee High School and all of the elementary schools that fall up under it.
I'm Davina Hines, I'm in feeder pattern one, and that all the schools that feed into Carver High School.
And I'm Nicole Dalloway, and I'm feeder pattern one as well, and I feeder Lanier Zone.
Yes. Terrence Thomas, he had to go to class. He's feeder pattern two. He has McKee and Park Crossing. Yes.
And he's full this year, you know, with Park Crossing. Okay, and I want to go over their activities just to give you an idea of what they do. Now, first column you'll see is the affidavits that they file. Now, let me be clear. Our goal is not to file affidavits on campus. That is our goal, not to do that. But if it gets to the point that we have to do that, that means we've done everything. We've tried to offer them services. We've tried to get them counseling. We've gone by their homes. We've tried to do everything that we could possibly do to get that child in school. But if it gets to that point, then we have to file an affidavit because they're continuing to miss school, then that's what we have to do. In most cases, our affidavits are actually filed on the student and not the parent, because their age that they know right and wrong. And we found that most of our parents are thinking the children are at school. And you know, like one parent explained to me, you know, I drop them off at the front door and sometimes they go out the back door. So that's when we get to that point. But those numbers, in my mind, I wanna see them low, because that means that we've done everything that we could possibly do. So that's that first column that you're looking at. But if you'll look at the next column, these are the letters served by the DRO. And as you can see, Carver had 440, Jeff Davis 455, Lanier had 430, the Lee Zone 556, and Park Crossing Zone 335. That means that these district resource officers actually made contact with each parent on each letter served. This is not a letter we just mailed to them. They actually made face-to-face contact with them when they received these letters. So that's phenomenal in my opinion. The early warning letters are letters that we mail out to explain to the parent that we're inviting them to an early warning meeting because they miss 2 to 5, all the way up to 10 days of school. Then the early warning meetings, as you can see, that these are individual meetings that the district resource officers have with these parents. And these parents are actually contacted at these meetings and they're having face-to-face conversations with each of these parents. Again, after that first letter was already identified and given to them. Then aside from that, they also did, Carver did 156 individual home visits. Jeff Davis did 162, Lanier 111, Lee 154, and Park Crossing is 130. And that's actually when we go out to the home, knock on the door, and try to contact the parent that way. And that's what I was telling you at the last board meeting that was really helped us with that is that we've been afforded two police officers because sometimes when they won't answer the door for the DROs, they will answer them for young men and women in blue. So that helps. And then parental conferences. These are aside from the meetings that we have. So these are the individual parent conferences. And a lot of these conferences come from the letters being mailed out or the first initial contact. And these parents are contacting the DRO because they have certain problems that they want to get resolved on why they think their children are not coming to school. And it may be problems from anything from them failing in school, it may be problems about them not having uniforms, just anything. And the district resource officer then after that parent confides in the DRO, then they will link them to services that can help them get what they need. So they're their contact, so they're more or less their advocate, so to speak, that parent's advocate. These are individual phone calls that the DRO makes, so you guys can see that we pretty much track everything that we do, but these are the individual phone calls that they make. These are referrals. The next one are referrals mean anything from contacting a social worker to a behavior interventionist, maybe referring them to the behavior intervention center, just things that we refer them to. The AIP letter is just about like the compulsory letter, but the AIP meetings are an additional meetings that they took it upon themselves to do. I think it was year before last when we stopped doing AIP meetings. Well, they came to me and said that they thought the AIP meetings were beneficial, so if they can do that on their own, they would like to do it. And you know, I was like, we go for it, you know? And so when they did, and we found that we sometimes have more parents come to the AIP meetings than we do to the early warning meetings. And I think it's because the early warning meetings are held at the courthouse, whereas the AIP meetings we hold at the individual schools. And some parents are more comfortable coming to the school because sometimes it's intimidating having to go down to the court and be before the judge.
Tell them what AIP is.
Attendance Intervention Program. I'm sorry. And then I wanted you to look at our age, 18 plus, and that number has gone down tremendously because remember we were having a problem with students being over 18, not being in school, but we've really tracked those students down. And for the most part, most of them have stayed and they're on track, but these are the ones that were still giving us a little problems with their attendance, but they're still on track to do what they need to do, so we have to try to work. And then the last column is the grand totals of everything that they've been doing. So is there any questions or anything on that?
Where you have the DRO, which is the district resource officer, mm-hmm. The numbers where you have the letters, those are the letters that actually will, you know, get served. If it's different, then that means that letter was not dropped off. Because I noticed, like, when you look at it, it says 556, and take a look at Lee 556, and then the next column you have 555. So what's the difference in the DRO?
That's the letter that they serve. The early warning letter is a letter that we mail out. But the one that they serve themselves, and that's what she did.
Okay.
And then the next one is the annual discipline review. And on this one right here, we basically break it down by elementary, middle, and high school. The total infractions for this past school year in elementary was 3105, middle was 6185, and high school 6247, which gave us 15,537. But something that I want you to note is that if you look at the students that are receiving the infractions, so you look at elementary saying that we have 3,105 infractions, but that is only 1,501 student that actually caused those 3,105 infractions. So in other words, one student may receive three or four infractions. So when you look at those numbers, don't think the 15,000 is 15,000 students. That's only the amount of infractions, but the students that are actually causing those infractions are only 6,056, which in a system with 30,000 students, that's really not a bad number. I mean, in a perfect world, we want it to be 10, but right now, we're just not going to get it. Yes, sir.
Relative to these infractions, and I see you said, well, 3,105 in elementary, mm-hmm. only 1,501 students really more so involved in these infractions. Do you categorize these in regards to whether it's A, B, C infractions? Certainly, I would expect more of the A than the B or the C.
Right. I don't know if it's in here, Mr. Porter, for you.
I think it's
kind of. Yeah, it is. It's further down. Yeah, but we do categorize it by A, B, C, D. Okay. Okay, and then, okay, I'm sorry.
I'm just asking, I'm trying to be nitpicky, but what, if we broke down truancy by school and garbage up there before they're in league, why didn't we break down infraction by school?
Well, actually, we didn't break that down by school because the state doesn't require that. They require your infractions to be on the level. And then the truancy activity, I thought that was important to break down by school because the district resource officers represent different feeder patterns and different zones. So I thought that would be important. We could have done this one by elementary, middle, and high also, but since they represent certain schools, that's why I thought it was important to break it down like that.
I've had complaints of office referrals, you know, not being taken, and it would be nice. I mean, I'm just telling you, I would find it important to find it for school, just like we did for that.
I'm sure I can get you that information if that's what you need. Now, as far as office referrals not being taken, what do you mean?
Well, I mean, if you listen to the teachers that are complaining, they're still complaining that they're not allowed to write office referrals for certain things. And I knew that some substitutes have been let go because they did write office referrals. I think it's probably the number one complaint still of teachers. It's the most I'm getting.
Okay, that's probably executive director, something that they can address. Okay, so going back to the discipline review.
The policy handbook in terms of what students receive as it relates to those discipline, those infractions is laid out. And then if a teacher has a problem, then certainly all you got to do is policy states very clearly what those infractions are as well as the consequences. So certainly I don't see why a teacher would have a problem writing a referral relative to the policy that we have in place.
There are occasions when principals ask teachers to first utilize their classroom plan the school plan.
Right.
So that could be, but I mean, I don't know
that. We have a discipline plan in each classroom.
Right.
And it should be posted.
That's okay.
And just to add on that, Superintendent, all office referrals have a teacher copy. And what I try to tell teachers is, you can write the referral, but it's the administrator's decision on the consequence for the child. But they do keep a copy of it. Okay.
I want to point out, teachers wouldn't be complaining as much as they are if the principal was backing them and supporting them on what they're writing and what they're telling them.
Dr. King, if you would talk to the executive director.
If it's a particular school, then
I was only commenting back to the comment that was just made. I felt like I was being kind of flushed out, like, what's my, you know, all I did was react.
Sure, no, you're fine. But if you don't mind following up with that, we'll sure that the central office will cover that. Okay.
Okay, and then if you go down, if you look at the percent of students, student enrollment receiving the infraction, if you look at 14-15, we had 19.6% of our students that were actually receiving the infractions, which match up to the 6,056. So like I said, I do think that the number is a good number for the size of our system. Of course, you would always want it lower, and that's what we strive for each year. But for the size of our system, I think it is a good number. And if you come all the way down for the total out-of-school suspensions, if you look at elementary, they have 1,492, middle had 3,642, and high school had 4,090, which was a total of 9,224. But the total students receiving the out-of-school suspension in elementary was 946, middle was 1,653, and high school was 1,795. Which totaled for 4,394, which out of our total enrollment, that made 14.3% of our students that actually received the suspensions. Any questions on that? Okay. And then Tom, I'm gonna go all the way to MPS total infractions, the annual comparison. Yes. I'm going to go to that one because the other ones are just bar graphs of everything that I just explained. And on this one right here, Mr. Porterfield, I think this is what you were speaking of. It breaks it down by what the actual code was in the book.
Keep going past the graphs. Yeah.
Yeah. There we go.
And if you look at, and I'm going to point out two of them because the B9 defiance and the C17 fighting, those two infractions are two that the Office of Learning Supports, we're gonna tackle this year in our goals, in our goal one, and we're gonna tackle these and see if we can bring these down. And I think our goal is to bring these two infractions down by 3%, because these are two of our infractions that are high in our opinion. And so we're gonna use our supports in the Office of Learning Supports to help the school to try to bring these two down.
Okay,
and
that was
B9.
That's B9 for defiance.
Okay.
And
what about B10?
We wanted to tackle two.
B10 has more minutes.
Well, it does, but Mr. Porterfield.
Right,
but let me give you a reason for B10. We didn't tackle B10 yet because we know B10, we need more professional development with administrators. So we wanted to work first on helping the students, and with B9 is defiance, disrespect, and opposition to authority. So we felt with learning supports, we can help the students learn not to have those behaviors through our behavior intervention center, through our behavior interventionist, and through our behavior analyst. Working directly with the students. Disobedience, I agree with you 100%, but we think with disobedience, that's gonna be more professional development that we need to do with our personnel. So that's something we're gonna tackle next year. That's gonna be one of our goals. But this year, we wanted to work directly with the student for the first year for the Office of Learning Supports. And I'm not, this is something that Dr. Jones has met with us on, and we're all in agreement that this is what we wanna tackle. And then the other one was fighting, because these are direct behaviors of the students, and we feel like our office can help decrease the inappropriate behaviors of individual students. So those are the two that we're gonna tackle. So I want you to take note of this, because I'm putting us on notice that this is gonna go down by 3%. So if I get up here next September and they're not down by 3%, then y'all can just
change your
goals. Watch out. And the only other thing on here that I want you to take note of is our truancy activity. And if you look in 2012 and 13, there was 231 referrals written for truancy. 13-14, there was 123. And in 14-15, there was only 61. So the district resource officers really, really worked.
Is that working along with HFMI?
It's working in conjunction with them.
So they're,
Let me be clear again.
Okay.
The visits, the contact with the parents, and the serving is all done by the DROs, right? They monitor what we do.
Oh.
Right. And last but not least, and I did not do this last time, and I kicked myself for a week, but you only can look good when your people are great. And I know you guys know they're great, but the person that makes me look the best is Jana Langford, and I didn't introduce her before, and I felt so bad. So I want, everybody knows Jana's name, but they may not know her face. So Jana, stand up.
Yeah.
I know she did. Okay.
Thank you. And I've had parents really compliment you to me this year too. So I want you to know that they truly know that when they speak to you that you are there to help their students. And
okay.
I just really
appreciate
that. Okay. Proclamation naming October as Parental Involvement Month by Mrs. Mona Davis.
I'm sorry. Oh, we need a
October is Parental Involvement Month for Montgomery Public Schools. In addition to a lot of other things, the month of October is, but we're really placing emphasis on parental involvement. And there are going to be a number of activities announced in the coming weeks about activities that we're going to do to promote the month. The first is this proclamation that's before you. We're also going to pick, I think, the third Friday of this month as Take a Parent to School Day, which will be unique. It's something we haven't done before, so parents will get to shadow their student in school, and we're doing this with Dr. Parker's assistants and Gabriel White's assistants. So when I call them later, they can't say, they can't get out of here. It's on the record. Anyway, whereas education is the gateway to a brighter future for our children and our community, the Montgomery County Board of Education is committed to excellence and recognizes the important role families play have in the pursuit of excellence. Whereas the Montgomery County Board of Education strongly encourages parental involvement in our schools, setting high expectations, meeting with teachers, and taking an active interest in a child's educational achievements are among the best ways a parent can ensure that each student is on track to meet their educational goals. Whereas the successful partnership between teachers, administrators, and parents is one of the most critical factors influencing success not only in school, but in life. And whereas MPS Parental Involvement Month provides parents an opportunity to visit their child's school, ask questions, and learn about the curriculum, and explore ways to become more involved in their child's education. MPS Parental Involvement Month is an excellent opportunity for Montgomery Public Schools to partner with communities to raise awareness and increase support for public education. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Montgomery County Board of Education proclaims October 2015 as MPS Parental Involvement Month and encourages parents to remain actively involved in their child's education. And you all are going to take this action today.
I don't see it on the consider for approval. Y'all, tell me if I'm lying.
It should be.
It's not on there. I didn't know you needed it to be approved.
Let's suspend the rules.
Yeah.
So that we can.
Yeah, because we want to really get it out to the schools and let them know that we're doing this
right.
As a district.
Absolutely. So do you mind?
Madam President, I move that we suspend the rules and add this to our agenda.
Okay, do I have a second?
Second.
All those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries with 7 votes. So we're going to put that as 10
E. Yeah. Ms. Davis, could we possibly, you know, after the month is over, give special recognitions to those schools that has great participation with parental involvement, just like
yeah,
we do? We can recognize those schools that have.
Well, we are actually partnering with the Montgomery County Council of PTA to do something like that. We're going to try to see what school can get 100% participation.
Absolutely.
For PTA and acknowledge them during that month.
a motion for the consent agenda?
Madam President, I move that we adopt the consent agenda number 9, A, B, and C.
Second.
All those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries with 7 votes. Number 10A, personnel report.
Yes.
Oh, yes. Link passed the pink sheet. Just report that I've got yours. Thank you, Mrs. Briers, for keeping us straight with our pink sheets. We haven't had these in a while.
Well, school ain't just got here. She didn't want us to spend it on school.
Okay, thank you. 10A, personnel report.
Yes, I recommend the approval of the personnel report, certified and support.
Madam President, I move that we adopt the superintendent's recommendation for personnel report, both certified and support.
Do I have a second? All right, any discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. All those opposed? You're abstaining? Okay, so, Ms. Briers, you did raise your hand to approve it. You made the motion. I just wanted to make sure. Okay. Well, I knew that, but I just wanted to. That is true, that's why I asked. Motion carries with 6 votes, 1 abstention. Okay.
I recommend the approval of the E-rate contract.
Madam President, I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation for the E-rate contract.
Any discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries with 7 votes. 10C, fiscal year 2016 budget.
I recommend the approval of the year 15-16 budget, subject to any immaterial adjustments necessary to clear SDE edits.
Madam President, I move the acceptance of the superintendent's recommendation on the fiscal year 2016 budget.
With all the other things.
Yes. Any discussion? I just want to thank you, Mrs. Whedon, and all of your staff. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries with 7 votes. All right, superintendent's evaluation.
Yes.
I need to make that recommendation. Fellow board members, would someone please make a motion to approve the superintendent's evaluation?
Madam President, I move that we approve the superintendent's evaluation.
All right, any discussion? All those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries with 7 votes.
For the record, that's the processing timeline.
Okay, the processing timeline. We do approve it. All right, NPS Parental Involvement Month. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Ms. Briers is ready.
Okay. I recommend the approval of the proclamation naming October as Parental Involvement Month.
Madam President, I move that we accept the superintendent's recommendation as October the Parental Involvement Month.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All right, all those in favor, please raise your hand. Motion carries with 7 votes. The next meeting is Tuesday, October the 27th. This meeting is now adjourned.
Thank you.